yourselves, ready yourselves. Let it shine the light of Jesus in the darkest night. Whoa, ready yourselves. May the powers of darkness tremble as our praises rise. Till the whole world hears what we are calling out. Lifting up your name for all to hear the sound. Like voices in the wilderness we're crying out. And as the day draws near, sing until the whole giant rise, guess the demons by surprise. Holy nation, sanctify, let this be our battle cry. Ready yourselves, let it shine the light of Jesus in the darkest night. Ready yourselves. May the powers of darkness tremble as our praises rise. Till the whole world hears what we are calling out. Lifting up your name for all to hear the sound. Like voices in the wilderness we're crying out. As the day draws near, the whole world.
Can be seated. Yeah, that's the church.
Everybody. Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. There I am. Woo! All right. Just in time for my message. Kids, you can be dismissed. Go to your kids' programming. Today I want to talk about something that impacts all of us. We're concluding our We Believe series. We've talked about faith. We've talked about the sacraments. We've talked about the church. Today I want to talk about Christians living in society. This is kind of where the rubber meets the road for me. It's how do we live out our faith where we live, work, and play. And it's very important we understand God's principles on this, so I'm excited about bringing this to you. What do you believe that most Americans say about work? Are they satisfied with work or dissatisfied? How many would say that most Americans are satisfied with their work? Raise your hand. Okay. Most of you are right. Most Americans are dissatisfied with their work. 52% say they are not satisfied with work, you know? And just think about that. This is actually, Forbes magazine reported on this. This is the highest it's been in the last decade. Okay, so 10 years ago, the percentage was only a third of Americans were satisfied with work. Now, I wonder why the difference. 10 years, we've been through kind of a recession, people lost their jobs. Maybe now they're grateful that they have work, all right? Indicating that they're satisfied that at least they have a job. Most of our lives, our adult lives, is spent working. It's estimated that up to 70% of our waking hours are at work. And that's why it's important that we enjoy our work rather than just endure it. So today, I want to tell you your work matters to God. And I'm not talking about just your job where you get a paycheck. All of your work matters to God. It really does. It's important that we work and we see the right perspective on work and how we're to work. The Bible gives us a lot of insight. In fact, there's over 800 passages using the word work in them. So the Bible has a lot of insight. We are to enjoy our work as a blessing from God. I want us to read this passage together. Now, it uses some strange language like slaves, but instead of slaves, think of it as employees, okay? Employees, all right? That's more of a modern vernacular, okay? Colossians 3, 22 through chapter 4, verse 1. Let's read that together. Slaves, obey your earthly masters in everything, and do it not only when their eye is on you and to win their favor, but with sincerity of heart and reverence for the Lord. Whatever you do, work at it with all your heart as working for the Lord, not for men, since you know that you'll receive an inheritance from the Lord as a reward. It is the Lord Christ you are serving. Anyone who does wrong will be repaid for his wrong, and there is no favoritism. Masters, provide your slaves with what is right and fair, because you know that you also have a master in heaven. So how do these verses relate to work? Of course, the masters represent the employer and the slaves represent the employees in today's kind of thinking. So look at verse 23 here. Work at it with all your heart. In another translation, it says, let your hearts be in your work. First of all, I want to make the point that we are called to enjoy our work. Is there any other thing to working than get a paycheck? Are we doomed to be frustrated at work? Are we able to find fulfillment in our work no matter what it is? Or do we have to have the attitude of the bumper sticker that goes, I owe, it's off to work I go, you know? Or this other phrase, another day, another dollar, you know? Or another day, another 50 cents, whatever. Or are we really able to, through an understanding of God's perspective on work, enjoy it and do it with all our heart? Are we going to excel at our work because we love it? Jack Nicklaus, probably know that guy, one of the best golfers in the world, he put it this way: I firmly believe that people only do their best at things they truly enjoy. It's difficult to excel at something you don't enjoy. And I believe that one of the reasons we don't enjoy our work is because we have the wrong point of view about our work. We look at work as a curse. Some of us think it's a burden rather than a blessing. Now, so was work a curse originally? No. Genesis 1, verse 28. God blessed them and said to them, be fruitful and increase in number, fill the earth and subdue it, rule over the fish of the sea and over the birds of the air and over every living thing or every living creature that moves on the ground. And we usually look at that verse and that set of scriptures and say, oh yeah, God says go and multiply. God commands us to go and multiply. Rather than looking at this as a command by God to do something, which was to have dominion or to subdue the earth, rule over the fish of the sea and the birds of the air, to basically be a manager. God gave us a great job description. He said, I created this, now you guys take care of it. That was the original design. And we were in the holy image of God, that perfect image of God, when God gave us work to do. So work is not a curse. Of course, when man sinned, the curse was the struggle to earn a living. Genesis 3, 17 through 19 says, and so the ground will be under a curse because of what you did. As long as you live, you will have to struggle to grow enough food. Your food will be plants, but the ground will produce thorns and thistles. You have to sweat to earn a living, and that's especially true in Florida. If you work outside, sweat, thorns and thistles. How many of you are gardeners in Florida? How many garden? I think it's impossible to garden in Florida. Everything we try to grow ends up dying. We're not very successful at it. There's thorns, and you know, you plant the seed, you watch it grow, and as soon as it starts to grow, there's 1,000 weeds around it that you have to kill off. It's difficult. It is. Work is difficult. But work was supposed to be for our satisfaction, not just for our survival. So before, work was fulfilling. Now it is frustrating. But the original design for work has not changed. Listen to the words of King Solomon, one of the wisest men to have ever lived, in the book of Ecclesiastes chapter 3:22. He says this: we were meant to enjoy our work, and that's the best thing we can do. Enjoy your work. Enjoy it. Be satisfied. It is our calling. In the book, Your Job, Survival, or Satisfaction, Jerry and Mary White wrote this: work was satisfying. Man was not made to dread labor, but to be fulfilled by the creation of his hands or mind. When we contribute, when we make something, when we think something up, or when we do what God has asked us to do, that is fulfilling. That's part of the creative work God wants us to do. So, in fact, God was so supportive of our work that in Deuteronomy 8, 17 through 18, it says this, it is written, you may say to yourself, my power and the strength of my hands have produced this wealth for me. But remember the Lord your God, for it is he who gives you the ability to produce wealth. All of this is a gift from God. If you are able to make money, use your hands, use your mind, it's a gift from God. Don't say, oh, look at me, I'm so great, I'm rich, I earned it all by myself. Remember, it's the Lord who gave you the strength to make a living or the ability to produce wealth. Work is important. Like I said, 800 times in the Bible, God talks about work, more than he uses words for worship or music or praise or singing. It's your work that especially matters to God. So let's go back to the passage. Whatever you do, work at it with all your heart as working for the Lord, not for men. It is the Lord Christ you are serving. First point is enjoy your work. Second point is we have the reason we can enjoy our work, and that is Jesus. Jesus is the reason why we enjoy work. People think that only pastors work full-time for Christian service. Oh, boy, wouldn't it be great to be a pastor? Then you could do the Lord's work all the time. All of us are in full-time ministry. Every one of us. We serve the Lord through our work. Our work is our ministry, and it happens at the time of our baptism that we are given employment in the Lord's service. At the time you are baptized or you first believe in Jesus Christ, you are called into service, the service of the Lord. Wherever we go, whatever we do, we're acting as God's chosen people, doing the work that God has made for us to do. 1 Peter 2:9, you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for God's own possession, that you may proclaim the excellencies of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. You're different. You're chosen. You're selected to be this priesthood. And that priesthood applies to wherever you are, in church, outside of church, with your family, everywhere. You know, Luther had a lot to say about vocation. He really did. Because during his day, in fact, there were cities that had one-third of the population had joined the clergy. Okay? A whole third of the population had joined the clergy. Why? Because back in his day, if you wanted to do the Lord's work, you had to be clergy. You had to be called into service. So you were either a monk or a nun or a priest or a bishop or something. That was where the work of God was done. They didn't have much regards for the material world at all. In fact, he says this. He's talking about the verse that says, "Blessed are those whose thoughts are pure. They will see God." He says, "Some dreamers claim that in order to have a pure heart, people have to hide in a corner, enter a monastery or convent, and seek the solitude of the desert. They claim people shouldn't think worldly thoughts or spend any time on secular matters. Instead, all their thoughts should be about heaven. These dreamers deceive both themselves and others with their mistaken notions. They lead people astray and do a lot of damage. They consider secular leaders and institutions to be evil. Yet these are the very things that ensure a law-abiding and orderly society. These leaders and institutions keep the world running and are established by God himself. Scripture talks about having pure thoughts and a pure heart in a way that is consistent with being a spouse, loving and caring for your family, and doing everything a parent does. In fact, God insists that we fulfill these responsibilities. Whatever God commands can't be impure. In fact, it's his very purity that allows us to see God. When a judge carries out his responsibilities and imposes a sentence, he isn't acting on his own. He's carrying out God's laws and commands. If he's a Christian, he is performing a good, pure, and holy function. But a person in this position couldn't do anything if his heart wasn't pure. Even dirty and unpleasant work, such as shoveling manure or washing diapers, is pure and holy work if it comes from a pure heart. What makes work pure is the pure heart of the one who's the worker. And that's what we are in Christ. You know, we're given this amazing gift of faith and salvation and life. And so as we go out in the world doing our work, we do it in a sanctified, holy way, blessing the people around us, even shoveling manure or washing diapers. It's all good work in God's eyes. 1 Timothy 6:1 tells us we should have a good attitude towards our employers, too. All who are under the heavy yoke of slavery should consider their masters worthy of full respect so that God's name and our teaching may not be slandered. Now think about this. The slander or misusing our job and kind of disrespecting our employers is equal to slandering and dishonoring God. How many of us are guilty of that? Talking bad about our employer. Talking about bad about the people who are in authority over us. You know, in the Ten Commandments, we usually say the third commandment's only about the Sabbath. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. But we forget. It says, 6 days you shall labor and do all your work. And the seventh is a holy day. 6 days you shall work and do all your labor. 6 days you shall work. Yes, you need rest. But you need work. It's important. It matters to God. And so when we don't work, when we give up, when we shut down, it is disobedience to God. That's why in 2 Thessalonians 3:6 we're commanded, "In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, we commend you, brothers. Keep away from every brother who is idle and does not live according to the teaching you've received from us." Keep away from those who are idle, the lazy ones. And Paul had some really harsh words for those who refuse to work. "Don't you remember the rule? we had when we lived with you. If you don't work, you don't eat. And now we're getting reports of a bunch of lazy good-for-nothings who are taking advantage of you. This must not be tolerated. We command them to get to work immediately. No excuses, no arguments, and to earn their own keep. Work is a gift from God. Working for God rather than men looks like something special, too. He says, do your work not to be when their eyes are on you or to win their favor, but with sincerity of heart and reverence for the Lord. Work in such a way that at the end of the day, you can say, you know what, I earned my keep, and I can sleep soundly because I did my very best with my work. Now, by the way, I'm not just talking about the work where you get a paycheck. I'm talking about the work where you care for your family, you care for your neighbors, anything that's done, any kind of contribution to society and the people around you is work. I know we have a lot of retired people, and I'm not saying you got to get back to work. I know a lot of retired people that work harder in their retirement at all kinds of things, volunteering, service, helping others, than they do at their workday job. So working for God looks like, you know, not just when the boss is looking, but when the boss isn't looking. Do a hard day's work. You know, again, workers around America frankly admit that they spend more than 20% of their time, 7 hours a week, goofing off. That amounts to a four-day work week for people. And almost half of Americans admit to chronically malingering, calling in sick when they're not sick, doing it frequently. One in six Americans regularly drinks or uses drugs on the job. Only one in four gives their very best each day. One in four, 25%, are honoring God in their work. That's sad. That's sad. Missing out on the blessing of work and why God made it. So in review, first we are called to enjoy work. Second, we have a reason to enjoy work. It's a mystery God's called us to. And now, finally, focus on this. You will receive an inheritance from the Lord as a reward. It is the Lord Christ you are serving. God promises a reward when we work hard. Now, we'll be compensated when we work well. God will reward us for doing what is right. When we serve Jesus through our work, we receive what is said here, an inheritance from the Lord as a reward. Now, that is not heaven, okay? Right? Well, you don't get heaven because you work hard at your job, right? We all know that we're saved by grace through faith in Jesus Christ alone, right? That's Reformation talk. It's not by going to work and working hard that you're going to earn a place in heaven. So what is he talking about here as far as rewards go? What is the reward that we receive? When you serve the Lord with your work, he rewards you in very tangible ways. We get to bless people by serving through our work. You know, the Bible says it's more blessed to give than to receive. When we work, when we serve others in our work, we're given that satisfaction of doing work that impacts people and makes a difference around us. I don't care what it is. I don't care if it's digging ditches or, you know, shoveling manure out of the barn. All of it makes an impact. You get to bless people by serving them through your work. Second, we see our own physical needs being met through our work. It's great to get a paycheck, isn't it? Yay for paychecks. Yeah? Because it gets, you know, I get to go buy groceries and buy clothing for my kids and keep a roof over my house. Very practical results of working. Third, we see the needs of our family met. It's great. It is great to have food and shelter and clothing for your spouses and your children, all that stuff. Next, we have more than we need oftentimes, so we get to show love towards other people. You know, when we're talking about supporting, like, women's choice, making a kingdom impact in the lives of women, supporting that ministry, because God's given us more than I need. And I'm blessed to be able to bless people by showering love and gifts and support. And when we're aligned with God's will in our work, serving him, we're showing love for him. One of the greatest ways we show love is by our obedience. God desires our obedience, not just lip service, but the actions of our will. When we align our will with God's will about work, we're serving him, we're loving him, we're showing him that we respect him. And then finally, when we work hard, it is a testimony to the God we love and serve. like 1 Peter 2:8 talks about. We are proclaiming the excellencies of him who called us out of darkness into his marvelous light. There should be a difference between a non-Christian and a Christian worker. A Christian worker should be doing it wholeheartedly as to the Lord rather than for men. And in so doing, the boss should say, what's up with you? Why are you like that? You know, we serve the Lord in the marketplace. We serve the Lord in the church. We serve the Lord in our families. We do that all with the work we do. Interesting story. A well-known pastor tells about a member of a motorcycle gang. He was converted to Jesus Christ kind of dramatically. And the first Sunday, he did the only thing he knew to do, which was to show up at church. So he picked out a church. Nobody recognized him. He walked down the aisle right to the front. He knew he wasn't a normal churchgoer. Walked right to the front. Didn't know what else to do. And everybody was kind of staring at him. You know, he's a big, burly, bearded, tattooed guy, you know. Black jacket, you know, just didn't fit the mold of the regular church guy. It came announcement time, and the minister got up. He made an appeal for nursery workers. He said, we need somebody to work in the nursery. But no one volunteered. He said a second time, we really need somebody to help in our nursery with our kids, but nobody volunteered. And so this cyclist prayed, kind of an innocent prayer. He said, Lord, I want to do what you want me to do, and if you want me to go into the nursery to work, just have the preacher ask a third time. So the preacher said, please, we need somebody to help work in the nursery. And so the cyclist, he raised his hand, walked down the center aisle, and 40 women got up and followed him. Yeah, all work matters to God. Whether it's working in the nursery, we have many, many things in the church that we need workers for. And you know, it's interesting how God works in the hearts of people to call them to work and to do good work, whether it's here at home or in the marketplace. It's amazing. The world needs good, godly workers. I'm going to close with a quote from Martin Luther. He said, the maid who sweeps kitchen is doing the will of God just as much as the monk who prays, not because she may sing a Christian hymn as she sweeps, but because God loves clean floors. The Christian shoemaker does his Christian duty not by putting little crosses on the shoes, but by making good shoes because God is interested in good craftsmanship. God cares about all of that stuff. It's not sacred or secular. It's altogether the work of God. Whether it's work in the marketplace, work in the home, work in the church, it all matters to God. And it is good. Amen? Amen. Love your work.
Bring him up. Or out, I should say. Hey, April, Tim, come on out. And actually, Nick, too. So, you guys can be hooked up. Just unplug and come over here with your guitars. Or don't bring the keyboard over. No. Not a good idea. We'll leave that there. It's a bittersweet in many ways.
Yeah, isn't it is.
Yeah. So, yeah. I mean, just and I didn't announce it at the start, but you know, as we conclude this at 12:30. There's a low country boil. If you haven't had that opportunity,
we're right on time, so we're not going to drag this out.
Yeah, not going to drag this out. Okay.
And then DJ, we want you to come down here too.
I'm sorry, DJ. My bad.
Part of the team here.
Come on in here, right here next to
recruits. So, yeah. Just jump off the stage.
Yep.
That's awesome.
All right. You know, it's the Low Country Boil. If you've never been there, we're going to be dumping food out on the tables at like 12:30. So,
yeah.
And it's really good. It's be awesome. So that's one thing. The other thing I forgot to mention, too, was if you head out these doors, the school has their auction. It's their only fundraiser for the year. And they're set up in the hallway of the church office. You can go through those doors, and there's folks over there that can give you silent bidding numbers. If there's any of the stuff over there you'd like to bid on, that can be a great blessing to the school.
Yeah.
So, but right now, this is what we're at. So,
yeah,
Pastor Ron,
yeah,
why don't
yeah,
you start?
Yeah. We're doing two things at the same time. We're welcoming Nick as our new contemporary worship leader and DJ. Yeah. DJ, is going to be in charge of sound and audio. And good luck with that, because you know
what it's a big job.
Reverb. Okay. But we are super gifted. God gives us good gifts, and he's given us a gift in you guys, and we're so excited, and we want to welcome both of you. And we also want to say goodbye. That's hard to do.
Yeah.
But you've been such a big part of this church's life for the last 10 years. You've been part of a re-envisioning who we are and what we do in a ministry. And I'm not going to spill the beans. You have to come to hear their full story, okay? Because I'm going to share some fun stuff, and we're going to do a little roast. Please, everybody come and celebrate. So, yeah. There's a lot of crazy
stuff.
We'll
be nice, not.
Yeah, well, no. I didn't tell them to be nice, so I'm going to be nice. But anyway, we do want to send you off with prayers and blessings.
Yeah.
And thank you so much for what you've done. You mean so much to us, and you've meant so much to me. Mm-hmm. As a brother and sister in Christ, I really see you that way. And you are tremendously gifted, and you are going to gift some amazing people over there in Clearwater. Yeah. So we know that's a good thing. So thank you so much, Tim. Thanks. So we want to say some prayers over you, okay? We know God joins us in that prayer as we cry out to him, so we want to pray God's blessings over all of you. Thank God for good gifts. God gives good. One of my favorite verses is that we have this God who gives good gifts to his children. Everything that's perfect, everything that's good comes from God, and these folks are gifts of God, so we appreciate that. I'll start, Andy, you can finish, okay? Everybody put their hands out like this, all right? We're going to bless them, send them off. Lord God, Heavenly Father, I thank you for these gifts that you've given to us. For Nick and DJ coming on board just at the right time, thank you for that gift. I know you're going to use it in a great and powerful way. I thank you for Tim and April, who have been a gift here for 10 years. 10 years they've devoted themselves to this ministry, this work, and we've watched it blossom and grow. We thank you and praise you for that. But now we want to bless them. We want to send them off in the name of Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, to guard and protect them and keep them safe, and to use them in powerful ways to transform lives. Lord, let that community over there in Clearwater know that it is faith, hope, and love that transforms. Let them be that light that shines in that place. Give them everything they need to minister in that place. In Jesus' holy, precious name, I pray.
Let my prayers echo along with the prayers that have already been said. But let me just speak to you four, but to the whole congregation as well, the benediction. The Lord blesses you and keeps you. His face shines upon you and is gracious to you. He looks upon you with his favor, and he grants you his peace. Go in that peace, that knowledge, that love of the Lord, and serve him. Amen.
Amen.
Can we play one more song? One more song.
Oh, How it's supposed to be played?
Because
I will stand upon your truth.
I will stand upon your truth.
And all my days I will live.